Hello everyone, welcome to the SharePoint PNP webcast. Our topic of today is our brand new SharePoint Access App Scanner. My name is Bert Janssen, I'm a service engineer at Microsoft, and my co-host of today is Vesa Juvenen.
Hello, my name is Vesa Juvenen, I'm Senior Program Manager in SharePoint Engineering, and I'll be asking questions why Bert moves along within the presentation.
Yep, thank you for doing that, Vesa. All right, so what's this all about? We just announced the retirement of Access Web Apps, which essentially means that we're going to stop creation of new Access Web Apps as of June 2017. So you will not be able to create any new ones anymore, already as of now. And we're going to completely shut down Access Web Apps by April 2018. Important note here is there is no change for Access in SharePoint on-premises. So if you would be running Access Web Apps in your SharePoint on-premises environment, things stay as is, no change. Access on the client, so the Access desktop databases, no change at all. This only impacts Access Web Apps running inside SharePoint online, multi-tenant, or DVNext. The scope of the Access Web Apps is both 2013 and 2010. So there is some differences between them. 2010 Access Web Apps was just like a specific site, actually, based on a specific template. 2013 Access Web Apps are a real SharePoint add-in, and they store the data typically in SQL, Azure, the backend.
To be fair, Bert, on that one, I think the 2010 Access apps, they were not supported in SharePoint Online, right? But in 2013, we then introduced the app Access service application, and they were supported in SharePoint Online, if I remember correctly.
Well, you can have them both in online.
Okay.
So at least I managed to create them both in my lab, so that's...
that is the...
Maybe that's not a good sign, but anyhow...
Yeah.
All right.
But like you said, let's be super clear on this one. This has nothing to do with the classic Access Access client or the MDB files, what they are. So all of that will remain. Access is absolutely 100% supported in on-premises or as an Access database if somebody
is
using that.
Absolutely. That all stays the same. It's just purely targeting the Access Web Apps in SharePoint Online.
Cool.
Now, this announcement was made. And you might have the question in your head like, am I ready for this? Is my tenant ready? Is my company ready for the retirement of Access Apps? And that's a fair question to ask. And the first question that pops up immediately is like, wait, how many Access Apps do we actually have? Where are they? Do I have a lot of work in order to be ready for the retirement? Or am I already in a good state? That's the question that popped up, and that's also the question we're going to answer with our SharePoint Access App Scanner that we created via the SharePoint PNP program.
And a key point, actually, before we go through on this one, so right now, if you're a tenant administrator, you do not have any native tools, actually, to know if somebody is using the Access App in SharePoint Online tenant, which is a pity. So there's no kind of a governance rules or governance, let's say, visibility that, hey, is somebody using this or not?
Yes. And the scanner gives you, as an IT pro, as an IT admin, you have a self-service tool. You still have to run it, but you at least now have an option to indeed get to that list of Access apps in your environment. The scanner is pretty straightforward to use. I'm going to do a demo after the slide. But essentially, you go to http://akk.ms/sppnp-access-app-scanner. Which will bring you to the GitHub site, which hosts the scanner, where you can download the scanner, where you find all the instructions on how to set up the scanner, how to do the creation of the app only principle, which is described here in step two, and actually do the run. So, but in summary, there's two big steps after you got it, is preparing an app only principle. We strongly advise you to use this approach because an app only principle with tenant permissions does have the right to read all your data. So we can find all the Access Apps sites in your tenant. if you do not use this approach and use a regular account, then you have to ensure that the account has the proper permissions. Otherwise, you might miss certain access apps, so your scan results would not be complete.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Since this app only principle will have tenant permissions, consider it as your admin password. So be cautious around what you do with this particular fellow. Right, once we have that set up, then the actual run is really, really simple. So you take the .exe, accessappscanner.exe, minus the, your tenant name, so Contoso, the client ID and the client secret, and off you go. That's it. So fairly simple. The scanner has more options where you can control. You can pick, for example, a username and password if you really want. You can also pick an enumeration mode. So by default, the scanner will work using search. That's why it's super quick. If you ever have doubts around, like, are all my sites actually properly indexed, you can always use the scanner in enumeration mode, where it essentially will kind of grab a list of all the site collections and then we'll just iterate over all of them to find the access apps. That takes way more time, but might be slightly more complete depending on what people did with the searchability of sites. Now let's have a quick look at how this works. So I'm gonna flip. First I'm gonna show you the site really quick. So if you went to that AKMS address, then you end up here on GitHub in the SharePoint PNP tools repository. And in there, let's actually go to the root, PNP tools, there's a solutions folder. Under solutions, you have a different set of solutions, a couple of our scanners already, and also the SharePoint Access App Scanner.
Just out of curiosity, Bert has to explain, this is working on the architecture of this one is exactly the same as the modern UI scanner, which we talked about within within the one of the webcasts, right? So it's using exactly the same process, which is essentially based on the PMP core component, the time at job framework, right?
Correct.
So it's using multi-threading and all of this inside of it. So it's a good, it isn't actually a great solution showing how to do other stuff as well. So not only just for access apps. So
yeah, but it's an ideal solution to reuse if you want to do some data mining on your environment or do like a large scale reading, fixing of data. Yeah, absolutely. All right, so in here, I think I would recommend you to go to the quick start guide. It explains you how to download the tool, how to create the app principle, which we discussed before. It's all detailed steps with screenshots, so it should go fairly smooth. Once that's done, you run the tool and then tool starts running. Now I'm gonna do it in live. So I'm gonna go to my folder. What I did already is I downloaded the scanner, the zip file, expanded the zip file like heaven.exe. Then I opened a PowerShell session. And now I'm ready to run. If I have a look here, I'm in that particular folder, so I can do this. Specify the command line, which I pasted in up front. So you see my tenant name, client ID, and secret.
Quickly,
if you're a European user, you can specify the minus E, which gives you like a semicolon delimiter instead of a comma for your Excel files.
It depends on preference. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Quickly on this one, so it's only one exe, so it doesn't have a dependency on C's, it doesn't have a dependency on anything, or how does it actually work?
It's one exe, but it's a special type of exe. It kind of, all the dependencies are packed inside the .exe.
Okay.
So, but it uses some CSOM libraries to make the calls to SharePoint. The backend.
Yeah.
Yes,
but you don't have to have any SDKs installed.
No,
on the
there is no confusion around SDKs and additional files that you have to copy around. You just have this exe and you copy it to your server or to your place where you want to run it, and that's it. So
cool.
It's really lightweight. All right, let's hit enter. The scan is starting. It does use search, so there's a search query to find all the sites of the particular Access web app templates. And then returns them. This is a lab environment, doesn't have that many site collections and access apps, so it returns fairly quick, meaning 5 seconds. Your environment will take slightly longer, most likely, but even we've run this for the largest environments, and it is really quick because assume it gives you like 5,000 sites to analyze. Those 5,000 sites will be analyzed in parallel due to the multi-threading of the tool. So really quick tool. All right, so the tool generates a folder, a timestamp folder per run, so you never override data. If I go into the folder, I have two files, access apps, which is the report. Scanner summary is kind of telling a bit about that, which scanner version was used. If there are errors, then you also see an error report appearing here. I'm going to open up this guy. Let's make it slightly more easy to read. Make it a table. Here we go. So what do we get? We get the actual URL of the site that is hosting the Access app. So in this case, let me also make it a little bit bigger, like this. So you get some sites hosting Access apps. You get the parent site, the site collection. So if you want to filter down on site collection, Access web app site title. And then I think the first really important field for me is the web template. You see we have two different templates, ACC SRV and ACC SVC. So this one is an Access 2013 application. This one is an Access 2010 application. So they are both Access apps. They're both will be retired, but they are different from an architectural perspective and also from a remediation perspective. So we have those types. What we get else is when was the Access app created? So you see mine are pretty recent because I've set this up in my lab. For Access 2013 apps, we have additional data around the last access date. So this is data that the Access team kind of has written into a web property back into the Access app site for us to retrieve for the scanner. So the Access app team is specifically adding features to Access apps to support the scanner needs. So this is one of the first features we have. So reporting on the Access 2013 last access date. More will come. We're looking into getting more details around the actual Access app itself, giving a bit more insight in, is this like a big complex Access application or was it a small one? Now, unfortunately for Access 2010 apps, we don't have that last access on date yet. So we are considering that. But in the meantime, I've added the last modified by user on, which is a property of the site. So this actually is the property when this particular site was last modified by a user. What else? So if it's 2013, it's based on an add-in on an app. It gives you the status, whether it's installed or retracting or kind of an app can have different statuses. The app ID, web ID is not super interesting. And finally, we have some data around the views for the hosting site collection, not for the hosting web, it's for the hosting site collection, which might be useful for you to give a bit an indication on, okay, is this particular site collection where this Access app lives, is it being viewed or not? If this is all zero, then it actually means that the site collection where the Access app is living is totally not viewed, which is a strong indication that the actual Access app is also not really used at all. So with this report, you can, first of all, you have an inventory of all the Access apps in your environment. And secondly, by starting to use the last access on field or last modified by and having a look at the views on the site collection, you get a strong feeling around which are actually actively used Access apps versus which are the ones which were created and then never touched again. because it's important for you to understand which are the active ones, because that's the ones you want to spend time on to remediate, and the other ones you can probably leave and let die in the environment.
Now, Bert, on one thing what's missing here is the kind of a logical next step, which would be, okay, we need to contact that Access App 1 creator or the people who are using that. Would there be a way to extend the tool, or how do I get the information around, okay, who should I contact?
That's a fair point to ask, Vesa. The tool doesn't list today like an actual site owner. And that's a fairly simple addition to the tool, which we should consider for the next version of the tool. Yes.
Yes.
For now, what you can do is you have the list of site URLs, so you can work with, if you're the IT person, you can write a PowerShell script, for example, to find out that information. But that's a bit clumsy. Like, the tool is already iterating over it. Why shouldn't the tool dump out that information? Yeah, definitely good feedback. Thank you. That makes it easier for you to contact the actual impacted people.
Cool.
Going back to the slides. So, a little recap of the report. I think we discussed most fields in the demos. It is more for reference. Just one quick note is some fields are only for 2013 Access Apps, some fields are only for 2010, and it's listed in the title, so don't mix them up. Quick input on governance controls. So the Access team already pushed a change to SharePoint Online, which does prevent you from creating new Access Apps, like we mentioned in the announcement. And that's done by a setting in tenant control. So if you go to Tenant Admin Center to settings, you'll find this Access Apps section where you see this as default. So by default, you can't create any new Access Apps anymore. You could still change that if you really need it. But nevertheless, even if you would allow it again, April 2018, it will be shut down. And so it's not really wise to allow it again unless there's a very specific business need. If, however, you run the scanner and you see like, okay, we are in a pretty good state, we're clean, or as good as clean, you can already disable it right now. Meaning, why wait? You can already disable it, and then you're really clear. After Access Apps is disabled, all the existing ones don't work anymore for your tenant. So if something pops up, which you don't expect because you did the scan, but if even something popped up, you know it up front before the retirement, so you could potentially enable it again, do some work, and then again disable it later on. So you have some control where you can play with. Let's about to wrapping up. Roadmap. This scanner is our first version that goes out now. We really love your feedback. So if you find, if you have comments, like Vesa, you had a great comment around adding the site owner. Any other comments or feedback you have for the tool, please let us know using the usual channels. So there is the GitHub issue list. I think that's the easiest one for this, where you create an issue, describe what you saw, what you need, your thoughts about the tool. And then we will incorporate in future versions of the tool. The Access App team is working on providing more insights on the Access Apps themselves, so that the report data will be more richer and will be more meaningful, telling more information about the actual Access Apps. And as already discussed as well, we're going to try to add the last access date for Access 2010 apps. It's only available for 2013 apps at this moment in time. Wrapping up, there's a number of resources. So the link to the scanner, you saw that one. This is the link to the deprecation announcement that I showed in the first slide of this webcast. And this is actually a really important link, Access App Migration Guidance, because it tells you what to do. Because we talked around, okay, it has been retired, it will be retired. Here's the scanner to find all the Access Apps, but what's next? So the what's next is described in this article. It describes how you can, for example, use Power Apps to rebuild your Access applications. It explains you how to export data from your Access Apps to other data sources. So there is guidance for you available. kind of move the Access Apps applications, which are critical for you, to move them to a different environment, to a different world, being Power Apps, or even custom development. It all depends on what you need and what you want to do with them in the future.
Yes, it's the classic story of first understanding what those Access Apps doing, the business requirements on the Access App, what is it trying to achieve, and then thinking through the options. Okay, is it a Power Apps? Does the Power Apps fulfill those requirements, or do I need to do a small SPFX solution, or how do we actually make this happen? But
yep,
different solutions for the problem, I would say.
Yes, indeed.
All right, so thanks, Vesa, for being here, for the questions, and for the good feedback. I'm ready to wrap up this webcast.
Cool, and absolutely, we recommend people to use this scanner to understand how things are being used. Like mentioned, obviously, there should have been a native capability for understanding how many Access Apps are used in a tenant, but there isn't. So this is a great tool for making getting awareness of your tenant situation. And then, like mentioned, when we actually did the demo, it is actually a great tool from an implementation perspective. It is an open source tool. If you need to have in future any specific by yourself, let's say, solutions to scan your stuff, you can pull down the code, modify the code for your business requirements, and do you use that as well. So it's not just for Access Apps. I think the reference implementation in here is a great, great way of doing other scanners as well. Because if you followed up on the PMP journey, we've been doing these kind of scanners now quite a lot pretty recently. So
this is number
because
three.
They're highly useful. Yes, exactly, exactly. And it's all based on the awesome work on the Time It Job framework, which is in the PMP CSM core. So who did that, by the way, Bert?
Who knows? Who's the guy looking around in my office?
Who's the guy? Yeah, yes. Cool.
All right. Thanks, you guys. See you all later.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.